Spiritual literacy. I've mentioned this many, many times, how super important it is. I've stressed this my whole life. I've tried to help everybody I meet. Folks, spiritual literacy is extremely important, and that someday if you don't do it, you will rue that you're not spiritual literate. It will be a catastrophe. So we continue to emphasize spiritual literacy here. And what is that? Well, how do you learn a language? Well, when you're young, it just seeps into you. You practice this, and it just through so many little opportunities. You take those little opportunities. A lot of people come to the United States, they don't speak the language, but they learn it. They have to. Well, that's changing, but they used to have to. And you know what? They do it. It's the same thing with spiritual literacy. If you feel you have to do it, then you will do it. And so I've always felt I have to do it. I have to do it. This is my last life in the cycles of birth and death. This is my last go around in that cycle. So I realized I have to become spiritually literate. Now, why is it my last go around? Because I decided it is. And meaning that I've realized there's no need for anybody to be a person, to be a human being. I realize there's no need, no real need at all for anyone to be incarnated, ever. There's never been any need. As long as we believe that someone, some spirit needs to be flashed, needs to be incarnated, we ourselves will incarnate. Because what we hold to be true for others, we hold ourselves, we can't help but believe it must be true for us too. All truth is one. There's not one truth for someone, for something, and then some other truth for something else. No, that's not reality. So we keep incarnating. We keep going through this cycle. We stay in this cycle of birth and death until we recognize that there is no necessity for any of us to ever believe that we need to be flesh bodies in a world. Time, space, process, and form. There's no need for anyone. Doesn't exist in reality. We're free. There's no needs in reality. We need to do this. We need to do that. We need to imagine ourselves not free, bound to cycles. No necessity. So when we finally are able to recognize this and see this, we realize there's no necessity for us either. We're free. We're free of the cycle. Now, I could appear here again. I'm free to appear or not to appear. But there's no bondage to any necessity whatsoever. So I knew this was my intention, and it was going to happen. So I better get spiritually literate, and so I can then handle, you know, make smooth segue into recognizing freedom, inherent freedom of all of us. And in the process of gaining that spiritual literacy, I tried to hang around and be listening to, reading, paying attention to the best teachers possible who are very highly spiritual literate, so I could, through osmosis, gradually, in practicing gradually, get this literacy, spiritual literacy. Okay. And it's like learning a language again. It just, you can't say, well, this, just do this and you'll know the language, or do that. It's a matter of constantly practicing, not constantly, but just as often as little possible. Little this, little this, little this, little this, little this, little this. Oh, let me take this opportunity. Oh, I want to know what time it is. How do you say time in this new language, or what the hour is, or I want to hold on. Okay, I want to say, be able to say nice pleasantries to people. Okay, what are the pleasantries? Hello, how are you today? You learn it. You learn pleasantries. You learn this certain this. You learn that. And you keep learning and keep gradually, and you never stop. I mean, I haven't stopped learning English. I mean, I still pay attention to phrases, and I often make up new words. Expand the language. Able to do that. How did English derive from other languages? Language comes from people expanding it. So, spiritual literacy is something we have to take very seriously. And the world doesn't take it seriously at all right now. This is a disaster, because when disasters come, you want to be spiritually literate, most definitely. Because options can be explained, options can be presented, and spiritual literacy will enable us to examine those options, recognize them, clarify them, accept them. Very, very important to know our options to be spiritually literate. So I keep on trying to do that, which at least enables us to get an experience, get experiences that help us out with being overall spiritual literate. It's not just books. It's not just this or that or theory or anything like that. It's more than that. It's more than that. We all have to be spiritual geniuses to deal with what is coming upon the world. 2:16 is very close now. It's about, wow, what, 15 days away or so. And this year is, I said we have to be confirmed in our decision of our destiny, what we want. What destiny path they want before we reach July of this year. We really have to. I feel that once we reach July of 2:16, I said this year, but I meant 2:16. Before we reach July of 2:16, we need to be confirmed in our choices, because once we reach it, however we're leaning, we're going to be pushed in that direction. So we may be on a fence leaning this way, we may be on a fence leaning that way, but come July of 2:16, I feel that we're going to be pushed one way or the other. Whichever way we're leaning, that's how we're going to fall. And nobody is actually neutral on the issue of what do they really want. Even though we practice neutrality in terms of that's just a term we use, is don't struggle, this don't advance or retreat temporarily in the wow. But we still are adamantly leaning towards what we really want. Okay, so we're just leaning, but say, okay, don't lean anymore. Just hold that lean like that. Hold the lean, full stop in the lean towards what we really want. So everybody's going to be pushed one way or the other. Okay, there's a notion of that both truth and lies can be true is not true. It's not true. And anyone who believes that is leaning heavily towards self-delusion, and they will be pushed into that. So there are drumbeats about 2:16 already sounding. We already know that this the nature of this world is imperilment. It's an attempt to change reality by trying to pressure our will into through imperilment, which is why we have bodies in the first place, why we identify of bodies, the idea that we want something that we can believe is us, that can be imperiled. Spirit can't be imperiled in any way, so how can we believe in imperilment unless we make something that can seem to be imperiled and then identify with it? So our identifying with the body, which we give the term I. It means spirit is trying to is believing in body identification. And of course, there is no real body identification for spirit at all. So there's no actual I. It's an inferred presumption. Spirit is doing this so it can believe in imperilment, and it believes that the impairment builds something, builds character, builds this, builds that. So it keeps bringing impairment upon the body throughout history, has done so throughout history. Never ending. 66 million years ago, dinosaurs were imperiled, weren't they? They most certainly were, by an asteroid hitting in the Yucatan Peninsula, Gulf of Mexico, and it basically wiped them out. See what? Severe imperilment, but this too was spirit. At that time, spirit was identifying with the forms we call dinosaurs, and imperiled that those these forms, so that it felt it could get some special will out of this imperilment. Now the dinosaurs are back. The mentality, the same mentality that decided to imperil the dinosaur spirit, believing in this imperilment, is back here right now in this world, which is why I'm saying it's a very, very much of a crisis now in the world. This is the same mentality that imperiled the dinosaurs and through an asteroid hit is now back in this world. They're calling themselves the good dinosaurs, of course. they haven't learned their lesson. It doesn't look like they learned the lesson at all. And they're back to imperil humans this time. Flesh is flesh. The belief in flesh is the belief in flesh. The belief is the belief in imperilment. Just desire, arrogant desire, whimsical arrogant desire, spirit to change reality, really. Change the will of God. And so this time, the plan is to imperil human flesh, and not dinosaur flesh, but human flesh. And of course, the dinosaurs being experts on how to do that. They say, oh yeah, we know. And not the dinosaurs. The dinosaurs were just appearance, body of flesh appearances. It's the spirit, the belief system the spirit has of whimsical arrogance and continuity fear, really. Keep in mind that no lie can stand on its own. It needs defenses. If it was just a lie without any defenses, would vanish in the face of truth. So it needs massive defenses. All lies need massive defenses, which is what this belief system that we call the ego is. And this egoic belief system that wiped out the dinosaurs, went through that imperilment exercise, is back here now in this world to impair the humans. The good humans, we call ourselves the good humans, but the imperilment imperils the good humans and the not so good humans alike. So, this is the trouble. The same mindset is here. The same belief system, and they are planning an imperilment. There's no question about it. Now, whether they pull it off or not, I'll tell you what, don't bet against it. Don't bet against it. We hope they don't pull it off, but it wouldn't be a surprise if they did at all. The mentality is such in this world. It's just extraordinary, the collapse. You go around, look at all the yards in your neighborhood. And wherever you go, in the department stores and shopping and everywhere you go, and tell me how many motifs did you see that have to do with Jesus Christ? How many motifs in all of this Christmas decoration and celebration? And I can tell you so far, I've seen zero. Not an iota. Not one iota have I seen. Now, go back 50 years, and it was everywhere, all right? Santa had to share the stage at that point. And, they'll have the artistic, manger scenes or something, but maybe churches will have those. But I'd be talking about in society in general and the yards of people. Drive through, I've been drive last year, the year before this. Not a trace. How quickly we have collapsed, you see. Again, the purpose of Christmas is to take stock of what efforts you've made in the past year, and you start focusing in on the next year. Say, wow, I've got to do, this is what I've got to do better. These are the good habits. I want to keep these good habits. I want to do better. It's a time for reflection and determination, because there's something we need to attend to, very, very important, we need to attend to in our lives. Jesus has pointed this out. Others have pointed it out. But Christmas is this time set aside through tradition. Let's take stock, very serious stock, of our lives here. What are we doing? What's going on? Why am I even here? Why am I identifying with a body? Big questions. Time of fasting, time of prayer, this is what it's supposed to be. Instead, it's the opposite of that. It's a celebration of materialism and ignorance. So, how quickly we have collapsed. If we don't think that we have collapsed, then just, again, find me Christ in Christmas right now. Now, maybe in California it's different than elsewhere, because people here are under the delusion that they're smart. Not all smart people, you know, become liberals or become lawyers or doctors or liberals or whatever, right? Some actually decide to listen to the wise ones and do what they suggest, which I have tried to do. Didn't try to use my smarts to make money. I could have. Get fame, I could have, all these different things I could have used. I could have been an incredible trial lawyer, actually. Could have been a doctor, could have done anything. But I said, you know, why should I do that? This is my last life. I'm finished with this. I want to finish with this. This is nonsense. So let's use intelligence and smarts to become spiritually literate enough to recognize and accept liberation from this nightmare, actually. It's a nightmare. However much you want to paint it up and put lipstick on it, it's a nightmare. So the way the world measures us all, it just says, well, you don't measure up, and you must not be smart. And I say, well, wait a minute. Just use example of lawyers, not picking on lawyers, but the idea is that people always told me, you're so smart, you should be a lawyer, you'd be a great lawyer. I said, why do I want to do that? There's a higher usage of smarts than that. Oh, you could have been a great this, you know. How come you're not? Well, thank you, but there's something even greater than what's being mentioned. It's how about being liberated from this nightmare? How about using smarts for that purpose? Nobody seems to... What? They say, what are you talking about? No, I want to use smarts to make as much money as possible, they say. That's the answer. And Jesus didn't say that. So, it's a time, all Christmas a time, reflect on Jesus Christ, who is certainly a great, great, great inspiration and teacher. I don't happen to believe in vicarious atonement, so I can't say that, but certainly Jesus is totally liberated from delusion and knows the way, knows the truth and the way perfectly. So you could say he's in the echelon of unsurpassable greatness as far as a teacher goes. Not that others cannot measure up in the same way, but he's, I would say again, in that echelon of unsurpassably great teachers. So we have this tradition of let's spend some time, like, isn't it smart to listen to an unsurpassably great spiritual teacher who is insisting that he has something very important to convey to us, and it's super important that we listen to this? Is that not worth some time at the end of the year to say, okay, how do we do this year? Take stock of the year. Instead, we are being extraordinarily distracted. And I know I'm just spitting into the wind here, because everybody's just collapsed. There's no resistance to this. But this is what you would expect. This is what we were told. In the end times, everyone would collapse. Their spiritual will would just collapse. And it's happened. It's already happened. I was thinking I'm going on a treasure hunt, look, just drive everywhere and say, where does any glimpse of Jesus anywhere, any store, anything, anyone have anything? But what's the use? We already know the answer is no, not really. I don't know. So there's been so much pressure applied to everybody that they all don't want to get in trouble. I mean, are we not getting in trouble by forgetting, not taking stock, spiritual stock? Then isn't that getting in trouble? So watch worse trouble, is it not? Because what if a catastrophe did come across upon this world? What if the egoic belief system, believing that imperilment is the alchemy we need to change our will, to give us extra will, which is what the ego does believe, what if the ego decided to strike, you know, strike the world with imperilment? Would we not want to be aware of that ahead of time? Would we not want to make preparations? Would we not want to know what our options were, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera? And would not knowing what these options are, would that not require a certain spiritual literacy? Something's click, 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 clickety, click, click, clickety, click, click, click there. Okay. Very quiet. Beautiful day in California today. Beautiful day. Cold. Biting wind. But right now, the evening, the dusk, it's a crescent moon. It's just a gorgeous cold December night right now. Hardly a breath of air moving, just a little bit now. So we appreciate these every day. And we're just getting warmed up here. Now, spiritual literacy cannot be gained in a day. How can we learn a language in a day? That's ridiculous to believe that. So, and spiritual literacy is something, is a lifetime engagement, really. If it's our last life, where do we go? What happens? You know, these are so many questions. But again, if we believe that life, that this life of flesh, this non-life, we might call it, is necessary for anyone, we will believe it's necessary for us. So, therefore, the freedom comes from giving freedom to everyone. When we're willing to give freedom to everyone, freedom from the flesh to everyone, then we too will be free of the flesh. The highest spiritual literacy is silence, actually. It's a positive silence that is seeing everything. Nothing's being excluded. As soon as we talk, there's a sense of inference of plausible exclusion, saying this is what's being emphasized. Whereas silence, you feel equal emphasis is being given to all truth, if this is this positive spiritual silence, or spiritual stillness, exemplified by Ramana Maharshi, and nothing was being left out, nothing excluded, no exceptions to truth were being made. Perfect eloquence, the highest eloquence. Now, Holy Spirit showed me something very, very interesting today, okay? So, we will get into that as we shift gears here a little bit. I happened to be at a weighing station, vehicle weighing station, and I looked, and it said 66, the 66 came up. I said, I don't like that number. So what do I do? I was thinking, why did that weight come up? Doggone it. And then I said, okay. So I did, I jumped in the air, and it plummeted down 180 pounds or something, whatever. I said, interesting. So I was jumping. I said, I lessen the load by making a jump. Making a jump, I change out of the 6-6 format, the materialistic format, replication, the materialism, 6-6. I said, and then I got this feeling. It actually, before this morning, I tried to do this jump up on a ledge. I tried to jump from the ground up on this rock ledge. And I hit my foot. I almost didn't make it. I said, wow. But I had this feeling, I got to make a jump. So I tried. I was first nervous. I didn't say, how do I do this? So in the scale again, I saw I need to jump to change, to shift. And I realized we need to start jumping, making little jumps. Very interestingly, I started jumping rope and hopping on my toes and doing physically making jumps now. It suddenly has come occurred to me to make these jumps, little jumps. So I would advise everyone to start making these little jumps and start focusing on that and get used to it. And I guarantee the more these little jumps you make, the better you're going to be at it. I'm going to get better at it. Lighten our load. These little jumps into something sublime. Little jump. Somehow we need to jump in, little jump into the sublime. A little hop. Just a little hop. We don't have to just get airborne. I did mention that those that instance of rocks rolling down a steep hill coming right at me, and I jumped over them. And right there I said, oh wow, I can jump over this. Jumping. Interesting. Jump. I can jump now. I haven't been able to jump for... I can't remember when I could jump. But it's a metaphor. Physical jumping is a metaphor. And the body... Somehow the body's following along like, yeah, let's... You know, the idea is getting to the body. Let's jump. The body's not thinking of itself, but the mind animating the body is saying, hey, body, I'm going to have you jump. I'm going to jump you. I'm going to make you jump. And the body jumps. But a jump meaning, well, we'll find out what it means. So there are these little breaks in continuity we need to keep practicing. This is the wow, we make this little jump, we feel a little break in continuity, and we go, wow, whoa, that was really something. I made a jump. It's like I jumped over those rocks. I was just like, wow. That was very intense. It really was. I mean, those rocks would have hurt. Get hit by those rocks. It jumped over. I said, wow. I can jump over this situation. I can jump over this situation. I can jump out of the way of this situation. That's what struck me. I could, the rocks coming in, hitting the carts. So the carts are what? Our vehicles, no golf carts, vehicles, bodies in this world. I mean, they came down, boom, hit the... I said, I can jump over this situation. Jump out of the way. I can jump out of the way of this situation. Then what did I hear just recently? Van Halen, jump. Dun, 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 dun. Hey, you might as well jump. Jump, jump. Time to start jumping. A jumping rope. I've had a jump rope. I went out and rummaged around, found the jump rope I've had. It's a good one. And I just kind of, a little bit every now and then, I've been jumping rope just occasionally. Now, I just did, close to 100. I think I did 40 twice or three times, maybe twice. Anyway, my legs are really hurting. But I was able to do sets of jump rope. which is pretty amazing. The legs are getting more spring into them. Spring. Take these as spiritual metaphors. Be a spiritual genius and read, you know, read between the lines in some way. Springing into the air. Jumping away from the situation. Making a jump and avoid the situation. Impairment. We don't need impairment. Why? We don't need bodies. We don't need bodies. We don't need a new will. We don't need to change the will of God. None of this is a necessity from the standpoint of reality. Therefore, it's no necessity at all. We cannot create necessity for ourselves. That's not possible. Now, I reached a goal, low goal of dieting. Yeah, but I was feeling pretty weak, so I've put on a pound and a half since then. Just started to eat some more. Trying to get the body to recover. Oh, I forgot something. Just continue good habits. And you notice something you need to do, do it. You notice, just keep working at it. It's super important. The attitude of this world is one of impairment and an acceptance of impairment. They're attracting impairment to them. This is what I see. They thirst for it. They feel that this will trans the alchemy of transformation that they need. This is their belief. They feel it's a benediction, a blessing. The idea of using the body in any way, as if it had some effect on reality, is delusional. That something happening to the body can somehow affect spirit is completely delusional. Wishful thinking. This may be a better term. Wishful thinking. Wishful belief. It doesn't matter what happens or doesn't happen to the body. It has nothing to do with spirit. Now, it can't change spirit in any way. So, why even have a body then, right? Yeah, why even have a body? That's right. It's much ado about nothing. Certainly, experiencing impairment doesn't do anything at all. It infers, though, infers plausible change of reality, which is all that spirit can do. When spirit had the idea of wanting to change reality, it realized that it can't change reality. So, all it could do was infer a plausible change of reality, to infer plausibility. That's all I can do. So this is what it's been doing, is just inference of plausibility. No evidence, no truth whatsoever to any of it, just inference. So it is using all these props, bodies, worlds, etc., to infer, plausibly infer, that reality is no longer real. It's been changed. again, there's not an iota of evidence of that. And it simply is not true at all. There's no truth to it. It's a lie. It's not true. So, we're so used to inferring plausibility, we believe that's our mind inherently is structured that way. That our mind, this is how the mind works. This is and light, this is how light works, as if it was bound, it has some structure to it instead of freedom. So we think that they can't stop doing this. So the mind, the light, that inferring that reality isn't real anymore is the nature of the new reality. This is how everything is this way now. Instead of simply, we are simply demanding that the light, this idea in mind, and of course light conforms to our ideas in mind, we're just insisting upon it. But it's not bound at all. We're not bound by our desires. We're not bound to insist on this idea or that idea. God doesn't say you must entertain this idea and none other. That is not the way reality is at all. But we believe that without inferring plausibility, we would cease to exist. This is our continuity issue that we have. We think, wow, this is life. Inferring plausibility is life. You can't know. You see, we can't know that we've changed reality, because if as soon as we know, we would know that reality isn't changed, because knowing is reality. So we cannot know. We have to plausibly infer, which is perception, actually. Plausible inference is perception. That's what perception is. So we think perception is reality, that we're perceiving reality. By perceiving, we are therefore real. I perceive, therefore I am. I mean, Descartes said, I think, therefore I am. We would say, the ego says, I perceive, therefore I am. And thinking is a part of perceiving, actually. Evaluating. This is the ego. And so, and of course, the whole modern structure is based on Descartesism, basically, right? Aristotelianism, Descartes, and this is what the culture, world culture, is based on. I perceive, therefore I am. This is not true. It's completely false, actually. What we're saying, I perceive so that I can believe that knowing is no longer knowing. There's no knowing anymore. That's really, I perceive, therefore I am whimsical, actually. So, goodbye to Descartes. I perceive, therefore I'm whimsical. However, the fact is we have this continuity fear that we believe that this is the new reality. So we say, well, I can't set down plausible inference. That's crazy. That's way too risky. So God knows this. Holy Spirit knows this. This is understood that we have this continuity fear. So the Holy Spirit says, fine, that's perfectly fine, no trouble, you don't have to set down plausible inference, just change what you're plausibly inferring. You could do that, right? Oh, it's like, wow, I like that idea. So instead of plausibly inferring that reality is no more, plausibly infer that reality still is exactly as it's always been. And what better way to do that? Well, here is certainly a beautiful way to do it, is the death-free realm, where we still keep the forms we're used to, nature forms we're used to, but instead of dying and aging and going through cycles and all this, they've always been there. They're immaculate. They don't age, they don't die, they don't get sick, any of this. Death-free realm. And this gives a plausible inference that reality is the same way. It hasn't gotten old. It hasn't gotten sick. It hasn't died. It hasn't changed. It, right? So it gives us this plausible inference. And we say, oh, yeah. And it becomes stronger and stronger. And then we think, well, I truly believe reality has not been changed at all. And then therefore the continuity fear evaporates to almost virtually nothing at all. Now, Jesus tells us we can see this world, but we're here, this world, you know, in such a way, vision of Christ, where everything seems to be tinged with light, and you see the living light everywhere, that you realize that this light associated with all these forms, it seems like that it has not aged or got sick, or there's no diminishment of it or imperilment of it or anything like that whatsoever. And therefore, we can plausibly infer that the light, this light we've considered, is the light of reality, and reality hasn't changed at all. So this is another way we can do that even while we're here in this world, to plausible inference. You can also be with great teachers, and they give all sorts of indications that reality is still real, that help our plausible inference. We can read books, that helps us. We can go to places that sort of have this timeless feel to them, that also helps us. There are various ways to be helped. But it boils down to the same principle of plausible inference, giving a different purpose for it. This is what it all boils down to. Because we are not going to drop perception. People say, well, we're going to leap back to reality. Well, that would mean dropping perception entirely. It would. You would no longer perceive at all. You would simply know. You would, K-N-O-W, you would know. Perception would vanish forever. And there isn't anyone here in this world right now who's going to do that. They're not going to just throw aside the perception instantly and that's it. So if we're going to keep perception for now, therefore we must give a different purpose to perception. There's no way around it. Must give a different use to perception. A different plausible inference to perception. Otherwise, we will just simply continue to plausibly infer that reality is no longer real, and therefore this is a new reality. Denying reality is a new reality, and because this is defending a lie and believing that we have to somehow sustain this through this will from impairment of the bodies, we will continue to identify with bodies, continue this impairment, and it keeps going like this. So what did I say before? Little jumps. Little jumps. Light around everything. I try to make, I try to make graphics that, the videos that have the imagery in them. I put sparkling light and try to put light everywhere. It gives us at least some taste flavor of what would it be like to see light around everything here. And the graphics give some sort of epic feeling of transcending, going into a more sublime realm. And so try to take a little jump into to viewing the videos, and it's a little different, but really, you know, we have to experience that which gives plausible inference that reality is still real. We have to experience, otherwise what effect does it have? It doesn't have any helpful effect for us at all. It's just words. We have to get the flavor, the taste of it, we have to experience it, we have to feel that this is true. So we all need more of that. Little jumps into that. And our jumping ability, our spiritual jumping ability, needs to be increased. We need to work out our spiritual jumping ability, which means maybe, you know, different styles of videos is helpful. different styles of videos could be helpful. I don't know. No one seems to watch them, so I say, what's the use? But, again, it's the experiencing of it. Just the notion of a realm that is more sublime than this one. I just feel like, just tune into that basic idea somehow. However we could do it, there's a realm that is just more awesome than this one. Much more awesome and beautiful and that's practicing jumping. Just practice jumping in whichever way you can. What are those guys that do those? I knew the name of it, but parkour, or something. Who jump, hopping and leaping over walls and buildings, and leap from the roof to this and that. That is quite extraordinary. It's stuff that you wouldn't think doing, right? But they see opportunities everywhere to jump. They see this, oh, I can jump here. It's really quite amazing. And we wouldn't think that we're walking down a street and we don't see the opportunity. For them, there's a wall. I can do a flip over that wall. I can run up the side of the building and do a backflip and I can leap up the stairway and then vault over this, and I could. They're always thinking about leaping and vaulting and just right. Well, we need to be spiritual parkours as far as seeing opportunity for us to do our spiritual gymnastics, our flexibility, spiritual gymnastics of getting flexible and used to the notion of jumping, shifting, jumping into something better, jumping into something higher. A little jump here, a little jump there. Make the jump. See, I see light everywhere. I see tinges of light everywhere. See, I already see tinges of light everywhere. I see everything enlightened. You see, if we want to hold anything at all back from enlightenment, we ourselves will be held back from enlightenment. If we want to hold anything back to infer that reality isn't real, that light isn't light, then we will not see the light at all. We won't see it. So only when we're willing to recognize that everything, all light is light. No light has been changed. Nothing has changed the light. No appearance changes the light at all. Only when we're willing for that will we see that there's light around everything. And this is just a still perception, but it plausibly infers that reality has not been changed. Plausibly infers it, so it's very pragmatic. I don't look at it as mystical. I'm not a mystic. I don't teach mysticism at all. I don't. We're pragmatic here. We're pragmatists here. This isn't some inexplicable mystic experience. It's just a super pragmatic. This is what we need, necessity to, because of the dynamics of our defense system, that's all. Holy Spirit, I find, is the supreme pragmatist. And thank God for that. Now, there are some traditions like Tibetan Buddhism because of the culture and where they live and the harsh, harsh, long, harsh, cold winters, etc. They would imagination with the eyes closed and sitting quietly. Their visual imagery, they became quite adept at visual imagery with the eyes closed, not looking at this world, but inner visual imagery, and then they worked with that visual imagery. But that's no different than working with the visual imagery with your eyes open. It's the same. It's the same. But it's just that it's convenient for them. And so they would work. They're very adept at working that those traditions, working with visual imagery and being imagined, and then working with that in various ways to ultimately plausibly infer that reality is still real. But we don't have to do it with inner visual imagery. We can do it with external visual imagery. It's all the same. It's all visual imagery, whether it's external to this body or not external, whatever we want to think of it. It's the same. It's the same. Different situations bring out different strategies. When it's real hot, too, people tend to sit quietly and work with inner evaluating their inner thoughts. But in a more temperate climate, we're more active. We tend to identify with external forms more than internal forms. So either way is fine. Doesn't matter which way. Just do it. You don't have to be adept at both ways, inner and outer. It's all the same. So you succeed at one, you succeed at both or all. It's the plausible inference that's important. It doesn't matter how you get to it. What if you see a tree in front of you, you see the tree is dripping with this beautiful golden light, and you see everything. You look at it. Well, that plausibly infers that the light is still light. The true light is still the true light. A powerful inference there, plausible inference, right? It's still not knowing, it's still perceiving, but it's a powerful, plausible inference. Or if you imagine a Christmas tree in your mind's eye, mental imagery, and you see that also dripping with golden light, then that too plausibly infers it. So they would go into this meditative state, but it's just dissociating with the external world, really, to help their imaginative states. But it's pretty easy to do if you're sitting in a cave for 8 months at a time. Whereas here, I mean, we have to drive everywhere in Silicon Valley. I mean, we got to drive every day, get out in this intense hustle and bustle. You cannot cultivate this type of detachment from the senses, from the world, as far as let the body just be inert for 2 weeks as you're doing mental imagery practices. Just totally unpractical here. Not pragmatic here at all. So I don't suggest that those type of exercises, but that doesn't mean that they aren't effective. They've obviously been proven to be effective by those who take that route. But it's just one route out of a number of routes that can be taken. Bottom line, again, is plausible inference that reality is still real. Plausible inference is perception. Perception is just another name for this plausible inference that we are using because we don't want to know. Because if we knew that that is reality, we say, oh, it hasn't changed at all. I know that I know. Knowing knows knowing. It's simultaneous, it, right? There's no separation. Oh, I know. So reality hasn't changed at all. So we try to substitute perception for that and insist there's no such thing as knowing. We can't know anything. I think, therefore I am not. I know, therefore I am. That's the false paradigm that this world is caught up in, among many other false paradigms. A super dark time in the world now. And again, heading towards imperilment. There's some... Yeah, the buzz will build in 2:16 about possible imperilments. There's no question. I've been talking about it for quite some time. This is the road that this world is headed headed towards. It's the road is headed towards imperilment, global imperilment. It really is. Now, the climate talks are over. I read a little blurb on that on the weather site, Weather Channel, and interesting, they danced around the legal U.S. Congress, so they vote down any binding legal requirements. So they got around that by claiming that accountability is the key, and that they're going to. This is just an extension of the 92 Accord, which the Congress did ratify, and that everyone has to begin reporting accountability at all levels throughout the world. And this is what I was pointing out before. This is the real aim of it all, is accountability, which is why technology is here to be used in this way. So this is going to go forward. This is the ultimate outcome, is this tech society of monitoring everyone and collecting data. And this doesn't have to be done. There's a way to do it without going through the governments necessarily, right? I mean, it can, cities, mayors, states, localities, people, everybody can start joining in. This is what they will do. And they will wiggle their way around any resistance to this, and ultimately you will have this society, however you want to describe it, this civilization that is obsessed with quantification. Everybody's monitoring everybody else, make sure that they do this, make sure they do that. What does that have to do with spiritual liberation? Has nothing to do with it. It's a side trip. And meanwhile, they're all focused on this. They're not focused on spiritual literacy at all, really. So it's a great distraction. This whole thing is very much a distraction device that they've cooked up. But it may all be much ado about nothing, actually. The dinosaurs were thriving 66 million years ago. Interesting that weight. 66 million years ago. Sounds like 65, 66 million, 66. Better jump to avoid it. Yeah. That number is very powerful. Mark of the beast. Maybe that's the, how long ago, the 66, maybe it was 66.6 years ago, 66.6 million years ago, where the beasts, the dinosaurs, that mark meaning the when it happened, the mark of the beast. Interesting parallel there. They were busy consuming one another, which is this belief in consumption. We could consume God and change God that way. And just poof, like that, about as quick as a blink of an eye, in the blink of an eye, the imperilment began. They said, this is what's going on here. And it's a chain of dominoes, chain reactions. So many, 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 many things happen from an asteroid impact. Not just the earthquakes and the tsunamis, that's the initial stuff, but it's a chain reaction of so many, 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 many factors that happen. So, for too long, that was it. Goodbye, dinosaurs, and then, on to the next phase of impairment. So we think, everything's fine. Doesn't the Bible say in the blink of an eye or something? It comes real quickly. No warning. Jesus said it'll come without any warning whatsoever in terms of our physical senses. It didn't say we wouldn't have spiritual warning. He's talking about warning, meaning you're not going to be able to see it coming, physically see it coming. You can certainly know it, certainly be aware from the from knowledge, realm of knowing, that something's coming. But that would have to be taken on faith, in terms of if we take our physical senses to be primary instrument of knowing. They're not the instrument of knowing at all. They're instruments of perception. Senses are instruments of perception. They can never be instruments of knowing. Knowing doesn't work through anything. Knowing is reality. So, won't see it coming. This isn't good. What do we do? All right, let's ask the Holy Spirit. What do we do? Holy Spirit right now says practice these jumps, making these little jumps. Jump into the sublime. So I dress up the sublime with this light, something that symbolizes rose petals, light, glimmering stars, snowflakes, glitter, all this stuff. Is a purpose for that. We have to start seeing light. Or in the case of the death-free realm, it's a little different than that. In that there's a perfect absence of anything living there being threatened with any change at all. And that's a powerful inference for reality, isn't it? That life doesn't change, is not imperiled in any which way. It can't be harmed or changed in any which way through seeing forms that have been there concurrent with our whimsical notion of changing reality. They've been there for billions and billions of years, it looks like. This is what I experienced. Like, this tree is like, I don't know, 7 billion years old or four, whatever. 4, 5, 6, 7, whatever. It's been here for billions and billions of years, and nothing has happened to it. Nothing bad has happened to it. It's in immaculate condition. So this is a super powerful inference for reality. But while we're here, we can also have an open mind to seeing light around everything. So I put the glitter in there. This is important. You look at a sage or something, and you think, okay, I can get it from this. Well, it's super important to see light. That light hasn't changed, really. That form has not encompassed light. That is not caged. Light is not encaged in form. It's not bound by form at all. So seeing this flowing, Jesus says, this living light that flows and ebbs and ebbs and flows and scintillates in this beautiful dance. It does a beautiful dance. He says the light dances around everything. This dance of light is, he says, this spiritual vision will show this to you here in this world. Now, I haven't seen it yet, but that doesn't mean it doesn't exist, right? It means I'm not yet ready for it. That's what it means. So take these little jumps into the light, into experiencing that this, again, he says, this exquisitely beautiful play of light around the forms of everything, tinging the forms of everything we see here. And he says, you've never seen anything so beautiful in this world. That's how beautiful it is. So, the videos I present with imagery try to convey something of very nature in a more beautiful format with scintillating light and play of light and going on taking place. Even the transitions are meant to golden light, silver light, this kind of stuff, to give us this idea. Get used to it. It's better than just sitting around moping and hoping, right? Don't mope and hope. That's a good mantra. Don't mope and hope. Just don't sit around. Just don't mope and hope. Practice.